Good evening. Welcome, everyone. Let me just start by saying that we are really pleased to welcome you here at our first event of the Dependance. We've missed it, doing something live. It's a little bit different than normal, but I hope it will be a pleasant experience for all of you. For those of you who don't know the Dependance, we organize lectures, debates, talk shows about what we think are the big political, economical, ecological, technological issues of our time. And we travel through the city of Rotterdam, and tonight we are here hosted by Theater Hofplein, discussing nothing less than the future of the internet. The internet, it's almost strange to call it a technology, but a technology that, since its introduction, has become so omnipresent in our lives that when you are in your mid-30s, which I am, it's sort of vaguely possible to remember a time when there wasn't such a thing as the internet, but it's almost impossible to imagine a future where we are less dependent on the internet than we are now. And this is, in fact, what we will be doing tonight here, discussing an alternative future of the internet. We will be talking about how the data economy is transforming our society, our cities, our lives. We will be talking about what the power dynamics are behind this surveillance capitalism, as it is called. And we will be talking about the possibility of getting out of here, about an alternative. The future of the internet and how to fix it. There must have been lesser ambitious evenings, but we will be trying to give you an answer on this, and we will do so with two outstanding guests. The first of them is the author of this fantastic book. I've just finished it yesterday. It's an absolute must-read. Three parts, I think. It has the first part is a personal history of the coming of age of the internet. The digitale stad in Amsterdam, in the Netherlands, in Europe, the early days of the internet. This is a story of hope, of experiments, a story where people are central. And the second part of the book actually tells how this story of hope and people central to the story gradually shifts to a story where it's not people but profit put central. This is a story a lot of you, I think, will recognize. And the third part of the book is about how things should be done differently. This will be discussed with Marleen Sticker. Our other guest is Payal Arora, author of this book, The Next Billion Users. She is a professor at Erasmus University, professor of technology, values, and global media cultures at the philosophy department of the university. And for this book, she has traveled all over the world, I think from Cape Town to New Delhi to the Himalayas and back, describing how the internet, or how technology as it is designed, ends up in the global south in a way that's totally different from what we think it does over there. They will both give a short lecture, and after that we will discuss with them and with you, obviously, whether the internet is actually broken, who did this, what we can do to fix it, and if there is a willingness among us, citizens, consumers, societies, cities, to actually change it. This we'll be discussing tonight with these guests. And the first we'll kick off with a short lecture. She's the director of WAAG. She is the founder of the Digitale Stad, which I think she will talk about briefly. She was my favorite zomergast 2 years ago, and she's one of the pioneers of the internet in the Netherlands. Please welcome to the stage Marleen Sticker.
The internet is broken, which is not a very nice message, of course. I think everybody experiences that broken is in the sense of trust, in the sense of that you feel that it's not really doing what it was expected to do, but also really broken in the sense how, in 2013, Snowden told us that all kind of vulnerabilities of the internet are being taken advantage of by companies, but also by the CIA and other FBI and so on. So the internet is also spying on us, not just only from the companies, not just only surveillance capitalism, but also from states. And states are spying to each other. So it feels as an uncomfortable sphere, let alone what's happening in the social media and the revelations of Cambridge Analytica about how our elections could be played upon on and how social media is basically profiting from hate and from cultures of denial of democracy. So, but I also say we can fix it. And but this, when I finished the book, I realized I had five ways of what I describe more in detail. In way of fixing it. And the first one, not always is being addressed, is that we have to change the narrative. We are living in a narrative of technocracy, of techno-solutionism, that all our problems will fade away if we have technology. So we need self-driving cars because we humans kill each other. We need learning analytics because we don't know how students learn anymore, because we don't know them, because the scale of educational institutions are too big. We need artificial intelligence to be healthy. So there's all kind of ways that we think that only in technology we will save all our problems. And I would say, well, we don't need artificial intelligence, we have to understand what social intelligence is. So we have to first understand what we are as humans and how we can build upon these social intelligence and also think about us as entanglements with nature, and that we can't do as if we are, that we just can bring all these artifacts in the world without having any footprint and effects on that. The second one is break up big tech. It's very easy to say, it's very difficult to do it, but I think there's a starting point. There is some willingness both in politics as there are some class action suits happening. This is one of the bigger issues. This is really luring up and make the rule of law again back into also the digital domain. And I think it's a little bit happening, especially in Europe, European Commission, coming from different perspectives. Of course, the GDPR, but also different perspectives. So breaking a big tech definitely has to happen. Reclaim economics. We can't just fix the internet if we don't rethink economics. If we think that markets will solve our problems, as most of the social democrats, the liberals, the conservatives still believe, then we will keep on giving our innovation to the markets. And these markets, financial markets and the real economy, are disentangled. So this is not a solution. We can't just continue. And I'm very afraid for the Groeifonds, the investment fund for the Netherlands, that they only think about how companies will have the BV Nederland, the Netherlands as a limited organization, will benefit from innovation where there are no rules for how this kind of knowledge and artificial intelligence and data become commons. Because I think commons should be at the heart of our society, at the center of our society, and not the market. And then, of course, we have to believe in another story about how we have to transform our societies. The internet is in the same desperate state as the planet, in the sense that it's based on extraction and not on regenerative models. So we have to rethink how to come to new ideas, new concepts, and more inclusive design and architecture for our technologies. And I think there's a whole notion about transformative innovation, which means that you're not going into, like, we have key enabling technologies that we're going to pursue, but we have to think about key enabling methodologies, what we want to pursue, which is more design-led and more inclusive. And then, of course, this is all more trying to fix the blueprints, the spreadsheets, the underlying principles of how we think about technology and how we work with technology, but then we also actually have to build it. So we have to build this open digital space, this digital public space, the internet as a commons, and it's possible and doable. Because this, of course, this is an image very recently where they say, please don't blockchain our babies, which I think is quite a funny one, because it actually is happening that people think that we can put our identity on the blockchain, and then when from the early beginnings, you will have your identity and it can be changed. There's all this kind of language and lingo going on in around the internet that I think is there's a mystification about what it can do and how it can save, again, some of our topics. So this statement, we do not believe in your technocracy, I think this is definitely something that is we have to be aware of, that at the moment there is this strange connection between people that are afraid for 5G, afraid for COVID, afraid for the mask because there's aluminium inside of the mask, which is connected to 5G, and Bill Gates. And so there's this sort of very strange conspiracy going on where people are trying to figure out what this all means and why we have to believe in technology. So there's also a very backlash of this technocracy and this techno-solutionism. So I'm not here to say that I don't believe in technology, because I do, actually. I think there's a lot of we have a lot to gain from it. So now we experience the technology as a closed black box. It's based big tech in control, extraction of value, surveillance capitalism, the human values and democracies are at stake. This is underneath the surface. So we only see the applications, but this is happening underneath the surface. This gives us this uncomfortable feeling. What we want from the application in the future is that underneath the surface, the technology is open and public, society is in control, it's regenerative in the sense that there's no value extracted, data minimalization, so not everything what we do is turned into data, and of course it's a fair and sustainable future. So the problem of this whole idea about fixing the internet and fixing technology and fixing society is most of it is underneath the surface, and a lot of people don't have access to what's happening underneath the surface. Where does it come from? What is actually inside of the black box? So we split it up in some layers. So we have the citizen's perspective. You have the technology stack, which is underneath the applications. There's a design process that makes the technologies. And there is the foundation, the fundament from which people design. A lot of people believe that technology is there and it has to be like this. But technology is not neutral. It's designed. These are human artifacts. So there is power inside of it. So you can say technology is not neutral, but you also can say technology is an expression of power. And so we have to clarify it, we have to demystify that. We can start with the foundation, so the starting point and the worldview that you have. So if you're a techno-solutionist, or if you feel that humans fail each other, then technology will save us. So this is we have to clarify that a lot of people coming from this idea that we need the internet for all kind of stuff comes from a specific worldview. It's also that they can think about where are we optimizing for? Who defines what the problem is? And why are we going to spend the money to solve that problem? So if you give a billion or a million to the CEO of a company or the shareholders of a company, they will spend this million differently on artificial intelligence than when you give it to the labor union. They will have another option. They want to they will solve another problem with it. So spending our money on technology is not neutral, and so we have to clarify who is actually defining where we are spending the money on. The second layer is the fundamental rights and values. So if we don't put them inside of the design process, we can't just add them later on. So I don't believe in all kind of ethic committees that are there to judge the technology when it's already being designed, when it's already being implemented, when on the surface of the application. And I believe really asking philosophers to sit in ethic committees is not the way to go. So ethics is in our action. It's in our design process. It's who was on the table. That is ethics. So it's a practical, ethical process. Another question that we have to solve is the social economic considerations. So who owns it? Will it be privatized information? Are we going to put the information and knowledge into a commons or an open source, open hardware? If it's not open, is it still accountable? So this kind of very, very easy questions actually to solve, but not the ones that will be, if you spend your money on closed technology in the hands of private partners, you know you're in trouble. In some years. So it's very strange that we spend so much money on those kind of closed technologies. And then, of course, the governance and the supervision. So how are we governed, how are we supervised this whole process? Is it accountable? To whom is it accountable? Who decides upon that? What kind of governance are in place? So again, not at the end, but at the beginning of a process. And then, of course, we come to the design process. And again, ethics is in the design process. So who can participate? Who defines the challenge? Or where are we going to optimize for? Who owns the outcome? This design process at the moment, I think we are divided in betas and alphas. I'm not sure if anybody can identify him or herself with either one of those. I think it's a really strange way to define ourselves in the type of knowledge that we have. So we need much more interdisciplinary processes. We have to have people that have knowledge about real the things that are on the ground, that are in the process of social processes, social innovation, together with people that understanding technologies. And since technology is cultural artifact, we have to see it as a cultural production and not put it aside as something for the techies, that the techies do, and then we from the other part is going to try to figure it out what they did. I think we really have to solve this also in educational institutions, but also in the way that we design the technology. And then we have the stack itself. The stack in itself, when I now open it up, a lot of people get really annoyed because it's very, then they say, oh, all these terms, all these terminologies, I can't really understand it. So some people think it's, the people that understand it think it's too superficial, so because they need more details to discuss it. But I think this is possible to make this more understandable for a lot of people, this layer, this cake of layers that the internet is. So it's not just the applications, this is also the hardware. Is the hardware open or not? The operating systems, all that kind of stuff that's beneath the surface. And we just had a very interesting discussion about around the COVID app. We had a very nice public discussion on a protocol, the PEP-PT protocol versus the DP3T protocol, which was centralized data storage or distributed data storage. And I think this was a very interesting way to discuss a protocol because it was clear that it's our political decisions. These are decisions about who is in power, who is in charge. So a distributed data storage on your own phone is really a different proposition than a centralized data storage with a state or a company. So I think it's possible to discuss protocols in a way that people understand that these are normal discussions that we also have about laws and about how we spend money. So the normal type of political discussions, but we have to engage also politicians in this kind of discussions and the general public, because otherwise we don't get it. We don't demystify the technology within the black box. So we can choose. We either stay with the private stack. At the moment, the internet is almost fully private when it's considered, if you think about the applications layer. There's a lot of open source actually in the stack of the internet, but most of the data and all the services and all the platforms that we use are closed technologies in the hand of private parties, and we are consumer to it, and sometimes we are even the product, as we know. Or we can go, of course, and say, well, then the state can do it. Like the China, a little bit, this is like the easy way to say, well, either the Silicon Valley version or the Chinese version, where the state it owns and has the closed technologies and you're the subject to the state. Or we believe in citizenship and we think that the technology should be a public stack and should be accountable and should be open and should be fair. So this is at the heart of the thinking of that a public stack is possible is that we have to rethink and re-understand what the commons are. The commons are shared resources maintained and or created by communities, organized around commonly defined shared rules. And we know commons as nature is a commons, language is a common, law is a common. So we have a lot of commons, culture is a commons. And a lot of data and technology can be also a commons, like open source, open hardware, the Arduino type of technologies. So if we rethink that the commons is possible and we rethink that this is an important element in the technology, we can then build these kind of applications on the basis of the commons. So this could also be an example. This is only one of my last slides about that this is not just happening at the moment in the digital sphere, but also in the life sciences sphere, with our DNA code, our bio, our microorganism code, we have to make this kind of solutions, commons-based solutions, because it's not just our social media, it's also our own biological, our own body and our own embodiment that is going to be privatized. Life is being privatized, is being patented. So this kind of data commons can be used in all kind of different environments, but it can also be used for our own genetic information. So I think if we try to figure out a way out of the mess that we have at the moment, it's clear that we have to start from this rethinking and reclaiming economic models, and rethinking and reclaiming the narrative around technology. Because otherwise we end up just doing a little sort of pushing back on being a bit afraid for the big tech and a little bit there, but we have to have a fundamental reform. And in this fundamental reform, it's not just about the technology, it's about how we deal with the planet. And I think this discussion about commons is at the core of our future. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Marleen, for your talk on this, the necessity for fundamental reform. Before we dive into a discussion about that, I would like to invite Payal Arora to discuss with us an alternative view, I think, on the matter, which is from the entire globe and how technology is used all over the world. Please welcome to the stage Professor Dr. Payal Arora.
Thank you. Okay, so, I'm going to obviously talk about surveillance. Surveillance is really a dirty word today, isn't it? It's got a sort of a negative connotation. When we think about surveillance today, we're thinking about corporations tracking us, harvesting our data, right? We're thinking about the nations that are sort of oppressing their citizens with their data. So really using the data against them. So obviously, in this kind of atmosphere and climate, we want to limit surveillance. We want to contain surveillance. And there's real palpable anger towards particularly new instruments of control. And that's the algorithm. So fuck the algorithm, right? That's making its rounds on the internet. It's going online, as well as going offline if you want to buy an enamel button on Amazon for $9.99. So it's very accessible. And so you can see that it's really something which is really deeply in our bones now, that we have just this blind rage against the algorithm. Because surveillance equals algorithms, right? Just sort of a mindless sort of a composite of the two. But here's my question to you. Are all forms of surveillance necessarily bad? I'm going to make an argument which is sort of unfashionable today. I'm going to actually argue for the virtue of surveillance, a certain kind of surveillance, which is the surveillance of care. Because what I'm going to argue here is that it is essential for an open internet, and even more fundamental for the future of humanity. We need more surveillance of this kind. So, surveillance comes from an old French term, which is to watch over. And in that sense, really, we're tapping into some kind of like watching over each other in a sort of a collectivity, right? To make sure and ensure we are okay. The sense of compassion and the sense of taking care of one another. And instead of being very abstract here, I will let Peng and Fan sort of illustrate my point. Now, let me give you a little backstory before I show you this little video clip. So these are farmers in rural China, and the story goes like this, right? They went through a lot of hardship, financial hardship in the last year, and then Fan, who's a husband, got into a serious traffic accident, and he was completely, you know, done health-wise, and he went into deep depression. So Peng, his wife, was really worried, and she said, we've got to get him out of it. So what does she do? She said, I got it. We're going to do a dance step. We're going to dance in front of our field, in front of our cows, in front of... Every day, we're going to do a little dance, all right? And initially, he was really reluctant, but hey, It's rural, countryside, what are you going to do? So what do? They invent the rural shuffle dance. And they do this, they involve their family, they involve their kids, and they're having a good time. And this is the beginning, you know, weeks of COVID hitting China. And so they're like, oh man, we're really depressed. So we need to like get our dance moves really out there. So they start to film it and put it on TikTok, and boom, they go viral. Millions of views overnight. They become an internet sensation. So look, this basically was a sort of a watchfulness of care, because what this did was it gave a lot of hope to a lot of people. So the surveillance of care translated into a sort of a providing a sense of visibility, to a population that has for the longest part been invisible, particularly rural parts around the global south. Okay, this was their way of saying, I am here, I exist, I will not be forgotten, and my story counts. It is also a sort of providing a sense of hope, as you can see with the millions of shares and reshares, and a sense of collectivity that the rural people are not something to be forgotten about, right? And it is really a sense of providing empathy and sort of humanizing the global poor, the vast marginalized majority that has for the longest time been dehumanized as a way to rationalize systemic inequality. And so, you know, there's a deep stigma about being poor, rural. In fact, they've been so flattened with the kind of poverty porn that, you know, surrounds us, that what this kind of watchfulness does is it turns the script around. What it says is basically that we are going to elevate people using these kinds of technologies. They do it themselves, right? They empower themselves to elevate themselves to the highest form of resilience and creativity rather than being reduced to their lowest common sort of struggle, their bad luck of just being born poor in the wrong place at the wrong time. So this is not an unusual story. In fact, I have gathered many such stories over a decade of my fieldwork in many parts of rural areas, in low-income communities, in slum areas, favelas, townships, from Namibia to Brazil and India. And this story resonates again and again, right? And so let me tell you one other story from my book. So this is Santa Marta, and some of you may recognize or remember the song, They Don't Care About Us, which clearly Michael Jackson had a problem. He really felt the empathy at that time. For the population in Santa Marta, which is a favela, which is a low-income community in Brazil. And, you know, it got a lot of limelight, but then quickly it faded away. And today that community still remains quite astoundingly poor. There's a constant drug gang warfare on the street. You know, there is a lot of tension. Cops are coming in and out. And there's a constant sense of fear and violence and everyday precarity, right? So my team went in to understand what are these everyday community members of this favela think about privacy and surveillance. How do they make sense of it, particularly because they were avid users of digital media? And what we found was very interesting, because teenagers would share their passwords with their mothers, and teen pregnancy, by the way, is very common in this area. So often they're single mothers bringing up their kids, and they're more like friends because of the age gap is much more reduced. And they would share their passwords with them, as well as with their partners, their boyfriend or girlfriend. And that didn't make sense, right? Why would you put yourself in such a vulnerable position in an age where you can actually completely become, permanently harassed or permanently revealed in ways that you do not want to lose in terms of yourself? And what we found was they would say this. They would say, yeah, sure, it's so annoying for my mom to constantly follow me and track me and ask me, I see you're with your boyfriend now. I read that you're going here, but you actually went here. And yeah, but you know what? I feel loved. I feel protected. I feel watched over. This kept coming again and again. They felt watched over. And it was not just them. It was also the neighbors, right? The neighbors through Facebook and WhatsApp would warn each other and say, hey, the cops are coming, or watch out because there's not food not here, but there's food there, etc. So there was a sense of community through this constant sense of watchfulness. We've got your back, right? So this kind of brings the story of, Jane Jacobs again, right, alive. And for those who don't know about her, she was this maverick thinker in the 60s and a major urban reformer, because she really understood how to sustain a common space, a public commons, which is basically one of her catchphrases, you need to have your eyes on the street. What she meant was that there needs to be people, the average stranger, caring about a public space and taking a sense of collective stewardship, right? That this is their space, that they need to take care of it, they need to watch out, and was particularly important for the safety of women and children. And so she really made a case for social surveillance, and this was in the 60s, as a way for ensuring the sustainability of a public commons. And today we see this in a lot of movements, including this poster, I don't watch my neighbors, I see them. I identify, recognize them. We make our communities safer together. And so this is really something which really captures a sense of how watchfulness could be actually deeply nourishing, right? Look, it's indeed a very difficult time. And this kind of thinking I'm appealing that we need to make it really, really important for us, because we're in an age where we are withdrawing from public space. When you look at what's happening in physical urban design, people are going behind gated communities because it is safer that way. They can be themselves, but behind closed doors, behind the walled gates, right? And that creates a divide between those who can afford to be in these gated communities and those who cannot, which is the majority of the world. And then you see it at a more, national level, right? For what was an exception, which is the firewall of China, has now become an aspiration for every nation, which is so bizarre. Now, every nation wants to have their own little firewall, right? Even the United States with their clean network, each one wants to have their own internet. So this is actually a very dangerous time. And then we have our personal filter bubbles and our black and white ideologies. And so we're moving and withdrawing from what should have been and what should, be a common space. And, if you see the kinds of initiatives taken in the name of empowerment at a very personal level, we should be alarmed. Like, for example, just recently, Twitter and Facebook has allowed you to lock your profile. And this initiative has been particularly targeted towards women in patriarchal societies in the global south. So they could feel protected, they could feel safe. And a lot of feminist groups in India and elsewhere have come and celebrated this initiative. I get it. I really understand that. But I would like to make an argument for why this is a very short-lived solution, because actually it is a very dangerous solution, because it's akin to digital domesticity. Because think about this, right? What happened to the unlock your potential to becoming let's lock ourselves, particularly women? And so sure, you go in the sort of safe space behind encrypted platforms and you can be with each other. But what you're actually doing is you're creating a new kind of digital domesticity, a sort of seclusion for women. Go behind the doors and do your thing. And so what these women can't do, and it comes at a price of freedom for them to capitalize on the attention economy to become seen and heard. And so we're actually reinforcing and amplifying already existing inequalities. So I'm just really tired of the narratives of negativity that surrounds surveillance. I really want surveillance to be reclaimed as something which can be about care, about compassion, about participation, because as a collective, we are, like as Jane Jacobs talks about, the stewards of our collective space. So we better start acting like it, right? We are all invested in that space together, and that's our pathway to get ourselves out of the hole that is also very much part of our social fabric. So with this, I thank you and looking forward to the discussion.
Take a seat. It sounds like I've been listening to two completely different approaches of the same subject, but maybe we have to go back to the initial question: is the internet really broken? Because Payal seems to think that there's a lot of good stuff going on. Can I invite you to say something about the metaphor? I think you borrowed from Shoshana Zuboff, stating that when you don't have to pay for a product, you are the product. No, she says, you're not the product, you're the carcass left behind by the vultures.
No, of course, I'm getting very confused by your enthusiasm about surveillance. And I thought maybe you mean covalence or something. I tried to figure out another word for what you mean, because I understand the what you say is that it's nice that people can take care of each other. I see you and so on, which is... And I think the examples that you give how people can broadcast themselves and have... there's a lot of... if I say internet is broken, there's still a lot of there, which is really nice. I mean, I'm not claiming that... otherwise, I would not like to fix the internet. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you'd be like, let's get rid of it. No, there is a lot why the internet is... there's a lot of good, which is the reason why I think we should fix the underneath, like what's underneath the surface of the applications that we use, the reason that we want to express ourselves, that we want to reach out to other people, that we want to care for each other. But I think it's impossible to make the term surveillance nice. I think it doesn't... I try to understand what you mean by it, but I think it's like with the term capitalism. You can't say we're going to save capitalism from capitalism. Because, but then you're getting into a whole debate about what it is already been defined.
Mm-hmm. But help us out a little bit, because you're saying that there's nothing good about surveillance. There are some good things about the internet. What is the worst thing? What should be fixed instantly? What's the worst thing about the internet at the moment? Is it the power structures behind it? Is it the loss of privacy? Is it people making money on us like we are and leaving us behind like a carcass? What bothers you the most?
I think, as I try to describe, it's beyond the idea that it's about privacy, because I think a lot of people say, well, whatever, I don't care. But I think it's about sovereignty in the sense of sovereignty of states, of cities, or of families, of individual people, in a sense that you know that you act upon your own beliefs and that you're not being manipulated into a belief, that you have the ability to choose without being already programmed to choose, mm-hmm, within certain limits, to be excluded or not excluded, to have the same, to not all have, that some people have the privilege and other people don't have the privilege.
But yeah, there's a lot wrong with the internet as it is. How does the analysis and the criticism, Marlene obviously is not alone in that, there's a lot of critique on the internet, on technology. How does that relate to your positive analysis in your talk, mm-hmm, and what's happening here?
Yeah, I mean, firstly, I see us having a lot more in common because we both are very invested in the commons in terms of a collective investment in something which is beyond the market and the state, right? And I think that's really the fundamental commonality between us. In terms, I understand the discomfort about the term surveillance. And, you know, that's because surveillance has been usurped by the sort of thinking in terms of infrastructures, in terms of systems in which, you know, society is organized. But it is given far less weight in terms of as a way of life, as a social practice with each other and our, you know, and technology is one, just one component. And being a digital anthropologist, that to me is my core concern, because even capitalism, right? I come from India. Capitalism is a nice word, because we came from a time where India went in, after colonialism, embraced the Soviet model of communism as the best way to organize ourselves, and we went and became extraordinarily poor. After that, capitalism kicked in a way which made sense to the Indian system. And this is my point. We continue thinking in terms of our context that we experience, whether in the Netherlands or in the United States, and we impose that kind of sort of interaction with the system, a set of meanings and values. Same thing with privacy and surveillance. Because surveillance means something differently as you live through it.
Let me get this straight.
Right?
Are you meaning, are you saying, we have got it so well sorted out in Western liberal democracies that this is a luxury problem. If this is the only thing you can worry about, that it's nothing. So
no, it's more about that. Look, here's the discomfort that I feel that when I have a conversation like this and I say I'm going to argue for surveillance, people get very disrupted. Why is it making you so disrupted? Because we are supposed to have a conversation where we can have the positive and the negative. Of course, there is very devastating forms of surveillance. So when I argue for surveillance, it doesn't negate the other argument. But we are in an age where we are unable to have that kind of conversation. Because if I take this position, I by default have ruled out the other. And in which case, this is why we find
But you are also saying that we have so gotten used to the positive sides of the internet that we tend to forget how many people are every day enjoying the fruits of this innovation and not really bothering about this small lack of ownership or...
Yeah, absolutely. It's not just it's not joy. It's become fundamental. Mm-hmm. For example, of course it is about joy, and joy is a huge amount of fuel that drives us, right? But it has become fundamental to a lot of societies that are completely invisible. For example, all of us are constantly complaining about, God, how many ads do we get? How many times are we targeted? From the time you're born, you feel like there's always someone trying to get your attention. Guess what? Majority of the population... Nobody cares a damn. When I was in the field, a lot of people were like from the slums, were like, I'm so excited I got my first ad. They were never an audience. They were never a consumer, which means they pay 2 to 3 times more for a product than you and I. And they have far less of an income. So they feel legitimized that they are a consumer after all, right? They feel legitimized when they're visible because the algorithm, and now they have their just sheer population. You know, for the decades, they talked about India and China's got the burden of its people. Hey, guess what? Now we have the asset of the people because we have the data. But data is a currency of a way in which you can say, I may be poor, but you want now something from me, which is my data. And guess what? I may be really poor.
So this is technology, and the internet is unlocking an enormous potential. And
exactly, because I'm willing to give you my data so I can have access to free internet so I can educate my child. Sure, you can talk about the rights and privacy. I'm like, you know what? Now, with my limited income, I have something to give. And yes, it is always relative to the conditions and the state you're in, right?
Would you say that, but you could also argue that the situations you describe are in just another stadium or another of the development of the internet. Maybe in about 10 years they will reach the same point where we have, they will be having discussions like these, because 10 years ago, 15 years ago, Marlene, 20 years ago, was enthusiastic as well all the time about everything that was possible. No, she wasn't. This is becoming an interesting evening. So this how, let me rephrase the question, isn't it just a matter of time until everyone reaches the point we have reached tonight?
Well, you know, we have so much evidence that we don't all evolve to the same template. I mean, we just have to look around. When, you know, the technology came about, they thought, oh, look at this. It's going to liberalize and open up. And even places like Saudi Arabia are going to become more cosmopolitan. And guess what? They started... Twitter is so popular in Saudi Arabia, and the imams have totally taken on. They are some of the top Twitter users. They have millions of followers, and people just assume that it'll become much more secular. We've always had these sort of simplistic notions that we're somehow going to evolve from this society to that, but actually religion has become twice as entrenched, while here maybe far more secularism has taken place with technologies, as economies have progressed and democracies have taken place. So it has evolved. Democracy in Brazil and India and all these other countries have gone into popularism in a way which has, you know, manifested very differently. So again, it's all about the social practice. And now I will yield, and you need to take the forum. At last, you've got the power of technology. You can carve your path.
Malay, what would you say? Is this optimism sounds surreal for you, or?
No, it's I recognize. I mean, again, you said, well, you must have been very optimistic at the beginning, and now you're negative. No, I've been always critical, and I've always been realistic. Mm-hmm. As a lot of people from the early beginnings of the internet, especially the people coming from hacking and understanding technology, they see technology as an expression of power. So you can do all kind of stuff with it. You can empower people, and you can surveil them at the same time. And of course, the story about this protocol. The DP3T protocol, which says it's a distributed protocol, and gives you the say about your data, is a different approach, a different way to think about how the internet can work than the version which some governments wanted to implement is a centralized data storage. And this was about proximity measurement of where you have been, that kind of information. So I think the discussion is not about is the internet yes or good or not good. It's about what's beneath the surface of the internet. Mm-hmm. It's the way that the technology is being designed. And so all the good stuff that you want for people, what they can do with it, you don't have to put it into the hands of some big tech companies. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So we don't have to say, well, we liberate people in India and we will give them Facebook.
Yeah.
And Facebook has tried to do so. He tried to say, well, Facebook is the internet. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So there's no other way to enter the internet but only via Facebook.
Yeah.
And I think a lot of people have discussed this and has political pressure also that
it
should not happen.
But it's also these big technology companies that you're critical towards that have made the internet so tasty that we all want it.
They made that I would discuss, because There's a lot of the inventions for social media, social platforms, the idea of sharing, all the kind of things, came from social innovation, came mm-hmm. from people themselves. What the big companies did is to accommodate them and to build them into a platform service. But this is not the only way to do it. There's a lot, so we don't have to stick with their model mm-hmm. to have the nice stuff of the internet.
Because it struck me, it was amazing to read. A lot of it I didn't know in the first part of your book, when you tell the story of the early days and with your involvement in it. A lot of the things we use now, I take for granted, were developed by then in sort of one way or another. Did you ever wonder why this model and these things that you guys invented in the late 80s, early 90s, did not make it, and the big tech companies were able to do something else? Why did your model
Well, why did the commons model didn't work out? Because in the 90s, I think the neoliberal climate really was sky high.
Mm-hmm.
So we started to see everything as a market: energy, water,
everything
transport.
Was privatized.
Everything
by
has
then.
Been privatized. Healthcare. So when the internet came into like the moment that it should have kept its public and public character.
Mm-hmm.
To see it as a commons, as a public space, with the governance of a public space. All the governments said, well, let the market do it. So in the Netherlands, there has been not spent 1 euro on the public domain. It has been always the government itself, so the state itself funded itself for to be digital. And of course, a lot of investment into the for companies and.
So you were 20 years too early, 20 years too late. What was it?
Well, I'm not saying I'm too. I mean, we have been on a wrong path, which is also that's why I say it's the same story as the story about the future of our planet. So we have markets that are based on extraction. So they extract value out of what we contribute. So this is if it's about the extraction of and the costs are somewhere else,
mm-hmm.
in labor or in conflict minerals or in the ecological footprint of I mean 20% of if you think about all the data and artificial intelligence and data centers and mobile and the 5G and all that will have 20% of our energy consumption in the coming years. So there's a huge ecological footprint of all this technology that will save us. So it's never been counted for. So I think we have to think about technology in a much more wider context than just say we only. I think there's a huge mystification around technology, and I understand it's a bit. I think both debates can be the same. I totally agree that I would not deny that for some people to have access to the internet is more important than not to have a data center in your country, because otherwise you would not have internet
mm-hmm.
access.
Mm-hmm.
For some, I think 4G. So
it's a trade-off that's made.
Sometimes the trade-offs. I understand that if you're coming from nowhere economically, having a broadband or a Wi-Fi or mobile is very important because you make a huge step. But I think we also have the responsibility to understand that this is not sustainable. This is not a way to sustain to have a good society.
Mm-hmm.
Not now for a lot of people. Not now. Not in the political sense.
Do you agree,
Payal?
It's an unsustainable model that we are developing now, and it's being developed in the global south as well.
Well, here's the thing again about the etymology of words, right? Like sustainability in many countries. Now, only a fraction of all the countries in our world experience liberal democracies. So majority of the countries that I study outside in the global south are a spectrum of authoritarianism. So I would say that, you know, corporations are like states. We need to stop thinking about the market versus state, because when a powerful company like Amazon or Facebook enters Myanmar or enters Bangladesh, they are actually, if anything, even more sometimes powerful than the state. And if they enter draconian authoritarian regimes, they are actually a desired entity, because as a citizen, I have, you know, I am constantly oppressed by my authoritarian government, and I have Facebook or, you know, I have Apple that can say, you know what, I'm going to kick out your app, your country app for COVID. And I think, like in Iran, that happened, right? They said, well, the COVID app of Iran is an espionage app, and we're going to get rid of it. And they couldn't do anything about it. So there is a sense of power play, because when you're a citizen, you want alternatives. And I think this is where the fundamentals lie, is do we have legitimate alternatives? I am not against, per se, a company like Facebook, Amazon, or any of them coming and contributing. They've provided a lot of joy. And I think that's not like whether it's Google Maps, or a lot of joy, a lot of ease, a lot of efficiency. The problem we have is hyper-monopolization. We don't have legitimate alternatives, which is what she talks about in terms of giving legitimate propositions of how to create a diverse, you know, set of ways in which we can have legitimate competition, in which case That's how we move forward. So we may have a better Amazon, but we'll never know because they are now the very grounds we're on. So in that sense, I do agree, right? So it's really but the way in which we approach it. It's not that capitalism is bad and, you know, state is good or the public. It's more about do we have alternatives from a micro to a macro level?
Yeah, searching for finding alternatives is one of the solutions you plead for in your book. There are a lot at hand at the moment already, being better and better and better. When we start to talk about solutions, let's start with the alternatives or with design. Is it possible to live in a lead a sustainable life, lead a be a woke a technological consumer? Can we get rid of what should we do? What should I lose on my phone?
Saying woke is really like woo. Means a lot of things now. Well, there's only one person I know who lives fully outside of surveillance capitalism. Michael Leenaerts from he only touches technology and has only a phone, so he's outside of the Google Imperium, outside of all that kind, and he can survive.
Of all the people you know who are really aware and critical of technology, there's only one. Okay.
Well, as far as I know, but that revealed it to me. That's maybe there are some hidden people. Well, you can also deny. You can also, of course, try not to use any technology, but I don't think that's a real option. But if you want to stay true to the idea that you don't want to spend money or lose your data to bigger companies, there's only one who can succeed, and it's very difficult, really very difficult. But it's getting easier. So, for example, I think most people know the difference between Signal and WhatsApp. And the good part is that Signal becomes a real... the first time that I tried to convince somebody to install Signal, it was very difficult. And now people start to use it because they understand the story behind the difference between WhatsApp and Signal, which is good. So there's something changing here.
And does this change have to do with the design getting better? Does it have to do with the culture toward the acceptance towards...
There's a lot of things at the same. I think the people understand the story behind it, so the reason why, because you need to be motivated to it. There are enough people that are motivated to be the early adapters, so that other people follow. But also the group around Signal, of course, their whole encryption, everything was totally top of the bill, but their design had some flaws, and now they added also the possibility to put smileys into it, and now it's a real fun thing. So everybody's so of course it has to be well designed. It has to also to have a good quality in what it is. So the problem for many of the good like privacy enhanced technologies are to not well designed enough. But ProtonMail, for example, is a secured mail, which can be a very good alternative for Google Mail. And they will launch a drive for documents end of this year. So you don't have to use Google Drive.
Yeah.
So
because we're
Brave
hearing Google
is a better
right
browser.
Now.
So there are more and more of these companies.
Google is one of the biggest enemies in your book, right?
I don't think I used the word enemy.
But it's my.
It's your word. I don't consider. They're not my enemies. But I just dislike them. That's also possible.
Okay.
I don't believe them. I don't believe them. I don't think they're not accountable. They don't pay enough taxes. So there are a lot of reasons why I think we should. And there I think you should not put attention to something that you don't like. You should put attention to what you like. So I spend my time trying to help those that bring alternatives, to bring them into the attention, to support them, and to make also a plea for supporting those. And I think if it's about public funding, I think we should be really, really, it's really stupid to spend so much of our public funding, of our governmental funding, educational funding, that they think it's normal that children under 18 have to take a Google account. I think that's really weird. It's really strange. So we should have some of those kind of ideas in place that we are not going to spend public tax money on companies that don't obey our rule of law. It's a very easy thing to do. And I think governmental institutions, educational institutions, cultural institutions can do so. It's really strange that we all use these platforms. And I think we should spend money and time to build other alternatives that are better.
Yeah, and relating to whether people are willing to take action and to sort of get out of the Google Imperium, for example. A couple of years ago, I think you were attending or doing something at a Facebook farewell party. You're describing this in your book, and it's actually a funny segment because it wasn't really that big of an event, right?
It was quite a big event.
Okay, I think you wrote in the book that it was a little bit too early, or people were not really. Can you say something about how that went? And
well, people didn't all consider it a party because they felt a bit betrayed, and they had, because it was in 2013 or 14, and of course many people like me, but many others already knew what was happening with Facebook. But it was a bit early to call people out and say, well, yeah, this is the moment to leave. So we had this liberation army, Facebook liberation army. And so we made a little fun of it, but it was also very serious. So the event became a bit, I don't know, some people felt like I can't leave. I still think this is a problem for people, mm-hmm. that they don't feel comfortable. But they don't know how to leave Instagram or TikTok.
Would you say that there is a shift in the willingness to step out of the to accept that you are what you would call in your book, I think locked in, and say I'm quitting? Would you say that the awareness and the willingness to quit is getting bigger and bigger? Has gotten bigger the last years?
Well, it definitely is. The concerns are much bigger. The political concerns are much bigger, especially since Cambridge Analytica and Brexit and Trump and so on. So there's clearly something at stake here, really at stake. So I think we don't have the luxury just let it go. Mm-hmm. It's not possible. Our democracies are at stake. Which doesn't mean we have to. And I think this the narrative in Europe is saying that we can rethink and rebuild the next generation internet based on public values, that we have the knowledge and the infrastructures and the money to do it. And this is what I'm seeing around me, that there are many, many people working on this. There's a program, Next Generation Internet, which is building up elements and building blocks for how to deal with a way that you can use your digital identity in a better way. Mm-hmm. How to the whole notion of sovereignty in data is already being built at the moment.
Yeah, but what do you think?
Far away.
What do you think about this new internet and the willingness in Europe to create sort of an alternative for the where you have the American model, the Silicon Valley religion, on the other hand, the Chinese model, and Europe saying we want to build a sort of more human approach to technology and the internet. What do you think about that ambition?
Well, look, in theory, it sounds beautiful, but it's not that people are forced, like kids are forced to getting a Google account. They want to use Google. Many people, it's not that they have a gun to their head to use these social media apps. They desperately want to experience TikTok. They want to experience all these other apps because, let's admit it, a lot of it is well-designed, provides extraordinary amounts of efficiency. And so in some sense, I would like to step back and look at these corporate spaces, whether it's Facebook or Google, etc. They are also a commons. Because if you take ownership, and think about it in a sort of a urban commons way, right? A lot of property, I lived in New York, a lot of property, public space, was actually not public. It was actually owned by corporations, so sidewalks, etc. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. But nobody cares a shit because
there are some people who care about that.
I don't mean in that sense. I mean that people in general will take ownership of that space. A company, right? When they, what are they going to jail them for using their corporate space? They may kick them out, but when there's a high collectivity and they have demarcated a private space as a public space, the culture has turned. So, for example, Facebook is the internet indeed for many of these countries?
So, but are you
right?
saying that this is a sort of the critique on technology and the internet is a sort of
I'm saying
academic discussion
no, no,
for
no.
just
I'm
a few?
I'm saying that look, Europe may have deep pockets, but firstly, they have. It's not like it's the first time they've done it. They keep trying. France keeps trying to get its own French internet, right? Every, you know, many different
not
countries,
the, please,
right?
Not the French. Don't use them as an example.
Okay, the point is, I'm saying that, you know, getting your own local sort of internet, your own local kind of technology or inter-regional sort of denies the fact that we want to be part of a global public. Mm. That's one, okay? The second is that a lot of these are basic common used as common spaces. So when activists like the Black Lives Matter are on Twitter, they see Twitter as a space of a, mm-hmm, it's a public mm-hmm, space mm-hmm. where they are protesting around the world, right? Facebook.
So what
has
would you
become,
say, Marlene, this, yeah. In practice, this is a public space. It is a common sphere. It is.
So it's about accountability, so, but
just
right?
To be sure, I'm not saying that we have to build a special internet here only for the Europeans. Mm. This is not what I'm saying. So when I'm saying you have to, so what's happening is, and this is not just Europe. That's there's also Americans and there are Russians. So this is a movement. This is a global movement.
Mm-hmm.
That does the idea to build a technology that the technologies for internet that are privacy respecting, sovereignty respecting, is something that is a global movement. So I'm not saying it's European special, and it's not just only for Europeans, please. So it's not like the French protection of your own language sphere or something. So I'm absolutely, but so no,
but
just
I think
just
to rephrase
Payal's
remark that in practice it feels like a public sphere. Why bother? For most people, they like to.
Because they change the rules. Well, because so there's no accountability. They can change rules. They do and we're getting locked more and more locked in. And I think I'm not saying so. I'm not saying that people are not allowed to use it, but I'm saying you should not force people to use it. So if this is the only, if there's not an alternative. And if schools don't have the money to pay for something that is better than the Google Mail, then we have a problem. So we don't
helping
spend
these big technology
companies.
So
if it's the only way for schools to have email for their children, mm-hmm. for their students, then we have a problem. So we need to spend our money well. And now we're spending a lot of the money to locked in technology and platforms. A lot of cities and governments and city councils, they're most of the technology is locked in. And they have to pay millions of euros to keep surfaced because otherwise they can't access their own systems anymore. These are really weird ideas, and so a lot of the most critical infrastructures that we have, financial infrastructures, organizational infrastructures, these are closed technologies. We can't solve the problems.
Mm-hmm.
We can't even so. This kind of locked-in societies is really dangerous, and I think we should go away from that idea that software and internet has only the quality when it is coming from companies. And it doesn't have to be so.
I would like to thank you for being here in this strange era and a half filled room. But it was great having you here. It was great having you here.
Thank you.
Payal Arora and Marlene Sticker.
Thank you.